One night, Bimbo got back home 2 hours later than usual. Her father was very mad at her. He asked her where she went, and she replied that she was with her friends. He hit her on the face when she said this. He said, "When did you start learning to disobey me? You even have the effrontery to stand before me and tell me you are with friends? You must be sick." He began to eat her non-stop until Bimbo hit him on the head with an object. He stopped eating her as she held his head in pain. Once upon a time, in a small Nigerian city, there lived a girl called Bimbo. Her mother is a wealthy businesswoman with many estates and companies. Unlike a loving and caring mother, her father, Paul, is very controlling. He would give strict instructions to her about when to go out and when to come back in. Her mother is very kind and warm, and she would often talk to her husband to be calm with Bimbo, but Paul would not listen to her. He would often accuse her of spoiling Bimbo, and they always argued because of her. When Bimbo was 13, her mother died in an accident, and her father started caring for her since then. Bimbo's life changed drastically after the death of her mother. Paul changed her school, and she was no longer allowed to play with her peers at school or in the house. And the friends often wondered why the sudden change. She soon became a victim of bullying because nobody wanted to be associated with her. The kids would call her different names and she would cry throughout the school hours. At a point, she started losing interest in school and she told her father how she felt. But he would hit her and force her to go to school each time she complains. Bimbo, the once vibrant and intelligent young girl, became very quiet and lonely. She doesn't have anyone to share her pains with, and it hurt her greatly. Somehow, Bimbo managed to finish her high school with flying colors. When she showed her father her results, he said he wasn't impressed because she did not get straight A's. Bimbo was sad that her father could not say anything good about her results. After her high school, she told her father that she wanted to further her education in a faraway town, but he did not support it. He told her to go to a school in their state from home if she really wanted to go to university. Bimbo could not argue with her father because she knows it will not end well. Months later, she sat for her entrance exams, and luckily for her, she gained admission into 2 of the best universities in her state. Bimbo was very happy. She shared the news with her father, but he doesn't seem really proud. He only advised her to concentrate on her studies and ensure that she doesn't make friends at school, and Bimbo promised not to disappoint him. Bimbo chose the best school out of the two. When she started her academic journey at the university, everything seemed to be going fine between her and her father, but she soon started making friends with some very outspoken girls on campus. Tola and Toby were her new best friends. The girls are very intelligent, and the three started sharing ideas and studying together. She also joined the school's union of campus journalists, as this was a great opportunity for her to voice out her pains and that of other students dealing with abusive parents like her dad. Bimbo was no longer the small girl her father used to know, and he soon began to see the changes in her. She also began to keep friends and went against all her father's rule. One night, Bimbo got back home 2 hours later than usual. Her father was very mad at her. He asked her where she went, and she replied that she was with her friends. He hit her on the face when she said this. He said, "When did you start learning to disobey me? You even have the effrontery to stand before me and tell me you are with friends? You must be sick." He began to eat her non-stop until Bimbo hit him on the head with an object. He stopped eating her as she held his head in pain. Bimbo apologized to her father, and she promised not to disobey him again. Her father placed an ice block on the affected area, and he did not say a word to her despite all her pleas. The next morning, Bimbo was all dressed up and about to leave the house when she found out she was locked inside. She was surprised. She called her father, and he replied that he forgot to keep the door open because he thought she had gone to school. He arrived shortly after with 2 cups of coffee in his hands. He hugged Bimbo and apologized for the previous night. Then he gave her a cup of coffee. Bimbo gulped down the drink at once, and she picked her bag to leave for school, but her father asked her to sit down. He told her that he had something to tell her. Bimbo said that she was running late, but her father insisted it was only for a few minutes. Bimbo sat down, listening to her father. Her father had barely started talking when she drifted into a long, deep sleep. By the time she woke up, she found herself in a room with one bed, a bucket, and a plate of food. She was very hungry, so she quickly ate the food. After eating, she moved around the room to see an opening, but there was nothing, no windows, no fan, and no door. Bimbo screamed at the top of her voice, but she wondered if anyone could hear her. She screamed and screamed for the whole day, but nobody talked to her. By evening, someone dropped her food via a little opening, and she tried to talk to the person, but they just walked away. She tried to recall how she found herself there, but she couldn't remember anything aside from taking a drink from her father. She wondered if Paul could be cruel enough to lock her up in such a place. She doesn't want to accept that fact. Soon, her stomach began to grumble because she needed to poop. She had no choice but to poop inside the buckets beside her. The stench from the poop was all over the entire room, and she couldn't sleep well. She tried to find an opening or anything to help her have an idea of where she was, but the entire place was sealed. After trying for this, Bimbo gave up trying to escape. Instead, she began to think of how best to survive living there. She doesn't have a phone to call for help or even a book to write. So, she started thinking of how to negotiate with the person keeping her imprisoned. 2 weeks later, her friends, Tola and Toby, were worried that Bimbo was not showing up for lectures or at her association meetings. Also, her phone had been switched off for days, so they decided to pay her a visit. When they got there, Paul answered the door. They asked him about Bimbo, and he told them that he has also been searching for her for weeks. He said to them, "I have filed a report of a missing person at the police station. I hope and pray she arrives safely." And he sobbed. "We are so sorry to hear that, sir. How can we help?" Tola asked. "We can't do much. We just have to wait for the police to come up with answers. I don't even know what to do or think," Paul replied, sniffing into his handkerchief. The girl stayed with him for a while before leaving. They assured him that they would do everything to find Bimbo, and he thanked them. Months passed and there was no sign of Bimbo. The girls had given up and the police did not know what else to do. It just seemed as though she vanished from the surface of the earth. One day, Bimbo's aunt, Mide, who was her mother's younger sister, came visiting. She asked her father if he had found her, but he told her that he has done everything a father should do, but all his efforts were in vain. She began to think of where Bimbo could be, but nothing came up. She told Paul that she would continue praying for her safe arrival. Bimbo has been trying to talk to the person who gives her food, but they never replied to her. She wanted them to at least give her some books to read to kill boredom, but they were not ready to listen. One afternoon, she got up to get her food, but she felt dizzy. She fell down flat on the floor as she passed out. She was woken up by a hot stroke of pains, and she wondered where it came from. She opened her eyes, but only heard receding footsteps. She wondered how the person came inside. For days, she felt very weak and tired. She also began to throw up and she wondered what was going on. She then remembered how she used to feel in a woman area every morning. It dawned on her that this person did not just imprison her, they have also been raping her. One day, she woke up to find a drug used by pregnant women tossed to her with a note. "Use the drugs if you like yourself and the baby. If you don't use it, I will have to cane you." Bimbo was shocked as she realized that she was pregnant. She cried for days and begged the person behind the box room to give her some books. As if her prayers were answered, Bimbo found the book at the entrance of the room the next morning. But it was a book for pregnant women, and it has a note in it. "Read this book thoroughly and digest it. It would help you during delivery." The person also gave her a pen and paper, instructing her to only write a note when absolutely necessary. Knowing that her chance of escape is very slim, Bimbo began to think of how to attack a prisoner. She noticed that a prisoner always enters the room at night and makes love to her. So whenever they give her food at night, she would trash it because she believes they must be lacing the food with sleeping pills. She would also try to stay awake for hours, praying and hoping that a prisoner would come around. One day, in the middle of the night, she heard faint footsteps. She quickly took the pen and kept it underneath her clothes. She opened her eyes slightly to see where the person was coming from, and she saw her father drop a ladder gently and climb down. It then dawned on her that she had been in her home's basement all these months. At this time, she was 5 months pregnant. She closed her eyes immediately, pretending to be fast asleep. Paul moved closer to her to check if she was fast asleep. Bimbo brought out the pen from underneath her clothes, and she was about to stab him on the neck when he held her hands. He hit her hard and kicked her severely on the belly until she began to bleed. He left her there, thinking she would bleed to death. She lost the pregnancy, but she was fine. 3 days later, Paul went back to her room during the day. He was surprised that she was fine. He explained to her that now that she knows he is the one keeping her in the basement, there is no way she's living there. He said to her, "I did everything to bring you up well, but you ended up making friends with those stupid friends of yours. You started disregarding me and even thought of leaving me." Bimbo was surprised that her father knew she was leaving home. It was between her and a friend. "How did you know I was leaving home?" she asked. "Well, I overheard your discussion with your friend on phone days before you attacked me. You told her that you were going to leave home and not come back again. I started preparing this room for you since then. And is that why you raped me too? For God's sake, you are my father." Bimbo screamed at Paul, sobbing. Paul took a deep breath and he replied, "I am not your father, and your foolish mother never allowed me to discipline you because of that. She loved you more than she loved me and even showed it to my face. To hell with her," he said as he kicked the poop bucket in anger, pouring the poop in the room. Bimbo covered her nose to prevent the stench from getting to her. Paul continued, "Raping you happened spontaneously. I never intended to do it, okay? I just had to do it," Paul replied, not knowing how to justify his actions. Bimbo was shocked at the discovery that the man she always called her father was indeed her stepfather. "How come Mom never mentioned that you weren't my father? Who is my father and why are you doing this to me?" Bimbo asked, sobbing. "You will find answers to all your questions in due time," Paul replied, standing up. "Now, I want you to understand that you can't live here, and no one can hear you because it is soundproof. So, I would suggest that you cooperate and stop trying to escape. I will get you anything you need as long as you do not try to escape again. But you have to earn it," he added. Bimbo doesn't know what to do. She simply nodded yes and cried as Paul left. She asked him why he's punishing her, but he ignored her. He continued to rape her every night without drugging her again, and Bimbo wondered how he could do that to someone who regarded him as a father. A few months later, she was reading a book when she began to feel labor pains. She screamed and called out to Paul for hours, forgetting that the room was soundproof. After screaming for hours without getting any help, she began to help herself by trying to push the baby. She laid the wrapper at the center of the room and she sat on it. She pushed hard and the baby popped out and she was relieved. She took the book and read how to detach the umbilical cord from a baby, and she successfully did it. Bimbo was happy that she and her baby were fine. She cried as she wrapped the little one in her arms, wishing and praying that everything she's going through is a bad dream and she would wake up from it one day. She slept off after a while and she was awoken by Paul's footsteps. He had come to drop her food as usual, but she informed him about the newborn and he came in through the ladder. He held the baby in his arms and kissed her. He placed the baby on the bed and went upstairs to get her some boiled water for bathing and drinking. He cleaned the baby and asked her to bathe at a corner of the room. When Bimbo finished bathing, she pleaded with Paul to please let her out for a few minutes, but he hit her and told her never to mention going out again, or he would take away some privileges she's enjoying. Bimbo apologized and quickly laid down. She ate her food and Paul went back upstairs. She named the baby girl Iriti. She would cry and sing to her baby, and she would hope that help would come to her one day. The baby began to fall ill every time, and Paul started to think of what to do next. Bimbo told him severally that the baby won't survive the basement because it is not conducive enough. After a few days, he collected the baby from Bimbo and placed her in a baby cot. Then he invited Bimbo's mother's sister, Auntie Mide, for an emergency meeting. When she arrived, he explained to her that he found a newborn baby on his doorstep as he arrived from work the previous day. He told her that his daughter left a note saying that he should take care of the baby and that she's doing fine and well where she is. "I decided to invite you to take the baby away since I'm a man with no knowledge of caring for a baby," Paul added. Aunt Mide began to cry. She said she hoped that Bimbo is truly fine wherever she is and that she would consider coming back home. She collected the baby from Paul and promised to take great care of her. Paul was very happy. He was shedding crocodile tears as Aunt Mide left with the baby, sobbing. 4 years later, Bimbo gave birth to another baby, but this time it was a boy. The boy, Mike, began to fall sick like their first child, and Bimbo pleaded with Paul to take him to the hospital, but he refused vehemently. Instead, he bought some drugs for the baby and asked her to use it for him. Baby Mike got well and Bimbo continued to take care of him, but Bimbo began to feel pity for her son because he doesn't behave like a normal child. She began to think of what to do and how best to convince Paul to take Mike away, but all her tricks did not work. After 18 years of being locked up and giving birth to two kids, Bimbo gave birth to two more babies in the basement. The first child is with her aunt, and she has three children with her. At this point, Mike was all grown up, and he was taller than Paul. He began to challenge him whenever he hit Bimbo, and there was one time he tried to stab Paul on the neck. Paul quickly escaped through the ladder, and he did not go to them for weeks after the incident. He would only drop their food through the little opening without saying a word or listening to their pleas. By the time he listened to their pleas and decided to go into their room again, his last child was seriously ill and needed immediate medical attention. Bimbo tried to convince him to take the child to the hospital, but he remained adamant. As he argued with Bimbo, Mike jumped at him, overpowering him, and he screamed for his mother to leave. But instead of leaving, Bimbo went upstairs to get a long rod. She hit it on Paul's head until he became unconscious. Bimbo carried her kids through the ladder and dropped them in the sitting room. Mike also came upstairs, and together they locked Paul in the basement. And for the first time in 18 years, Bimbo stepped outside the basement and she saw the sunlight. Her kids, who were used to being in the dark, covered their eyes as the sun rays entered their eyes. They ran back into the house and Bimbo began to cry. She found out that the community she once lived with her mother had changed drastically, and she wondered if anyone would recognize her after 18 years of being imprisoned. Bimbo did not have any money to pay for the hospital bill, so she asked her kids to wait while she went back inside. She checked Paul's drawers and she made a shocking discovery. Her mother's will was neatly tucked away under Paul's stash of money. The will indicates that Bimbo should inherit her mother's home and her company when she's 18. Bimbo then recalled that Paul locked her away a few days to her 18th birthday, and it occurred to her that he did all this to prevent her from taking over her mother's company and properties. Bimbo cried and screamed, cursing Paul for waiting 18 years of her life, all because of a will that she doesn't even have interest in. All she ever wanted was to go far away and live her life without her evil stepfather. Why did he have to stop her when he heard she was going away? Then it dawned on her that Paul must have thought that she was going away with the inheritance. She kept Paul locked in the basement, and days later, she thought of selling the house. She went to her aunt and explained everything Paul did to her. Aunt Midi told Bimbo that she always knew Paul is not a good person, and she warned her sister not to marry him, but she was blinded by love. When asked what she wants to do with Paul, Bimbo replied that she wants him to feel what she felt, so she wouldn't abandon him there and leave him to die without suffering. And she also said that she will not report him to the police because they may end up releasing him. She went to the grocery store and bought some foodstuffs. She tossed all the food and water that would last him for 6 months through the tiny hole, and she told them that she was living with her kids and she would be putting the house for sale after 20 years. She told him that she would be bringing him food every 6 months because she wants him to feel exactly what she felt. So she told him to manage whatever he has until then. Bimbo closed up the tiny space to prevent him from trying to escape, and she left Paul in the basement and moved to another city with her kids. Did Bimbo do the right thing? Should she have reported to the authorities? Let me know what you think in the comment section. Thank you so much for watching. Please subscribe, like, and share for more interesting stories like this. Have a great day.